G'day everyone, and welcome back to Our Paranormal World. It doesn't take any great powers of mind reading to guess what comes to your mind when I say the word exorcism. It's probably the movie, The Exorcist, but it could be the Catholic Church, or maybe a level of fear if you're a believer. Of course, your eyes could have glazed over entirely because you think the whole thing is a load of... That exorcisms exist isn't up for debate. There have been many cases of church-sanctioned and unofficial exorcisms over the years, but are they really combating demons? Or is it a case of mental illness coupled with a religious bias? For years, the Catholic Church regarded exorcism as somewhat of an embarrassment, and yet in the decades following the 1970s, demand for exorcisms increased dramatically, with the Vatican training more exorcists than ever before. Is it a coincidence that this followed the release of the Exorcist movie? In this video, we'll have a look at some surprising history around exorcisms, as well as exploring the mental health connection from the perspective of a psychiatrist who is a consultant for the International Association of Exorcists. But before we go anywhere, let me ask, when do you think the earliest record of an exorcism stems from? The first official guidelines for exorcism were established by the Catholic Church in the 17th century, but the Bentresh Stela, which is a hieroglyphic sandstone text now residing in the Louvre, tells of the expulsion of a demon from Bentresh, the sister-in-law of Ramesses II, who ruled Egypt from 1279 BC to 1213 BC. The Stela is almost certainly younger than that, probably written around 600 BC, and many scholars consider it is a work of simple propaganda, essentially to remind people of the glory of the most powerful period in ancient Egyptian history and the inherent power and beneficence of the gods of Egypt. Nevertheless, this stela tells us priests have been using holy rites to perform exorcisms for much longer than expected. The ancient Sumerians, Babylonians, and Assyrians, whose civilizations date back nearly 5,000 years, had a belief in demons and evil spirits, classing them as either departed human spirits or non-human spirits who would take animal forms. Of course, in this case, both of these classes of evil spirits would be responsible for anything bad that happened, from destructive weather right through to quarrels amongst ordinary folk. And if you're tempted to laugh at that, remember that the writings and pictographs of the ancient world is often presented as evidence for visits to Earth from extraterrestrial life. Yet, to some of those same people, ancient belief in demons seems absurd. The word exorcism actually comes from the Greek word exorcizen, meaning to bind by oath, which is suggestive of an agreement, but the practice of exorcism is largely a struggle to expel or banish spirits or demons using the compulsion of the powers of God. The belief in spirit beings, gods, demons, ghosts, etc., is found in nearly every culture on earth, and historically, almost everything which is undesirable, unwelcome, or misunderstood has been attributed to the influence of spiritual beings. Everything from weather anomalies to maladies of the mind and body have been ascribed a demonic cause. In the Christian Bible, Matthew 12:22 speaks of a blind and mute man being brought before Jesus, who is described as demon-possessed. And Luke 13:10-13 speaks of a woman whose crippling is stated as spirit-related. And ancient history is filled with such references where exorcisms are used in an attempt to cure physical conditions of the body. It wasn't until the Protestant Reformation and the subsequent Catholic Reformation, that possession was reframed as being a malady of the soul. I should say here that there are still some sections of the community who hold to the belief that physical illness and disease are caused by a demonic influence. However, medical science disagrees, and so do the major religions. Anyway, it is true to say that spiritual possession is a diagnostic model through which cultures have tried to make sense of disturbing phenomena. And a modern misconception is that exorcisms and belief in demonic possession is an anachronism, that it is simply a remnant of the Dark Ages and will fade away in this modern world. And this belief is tied into the secularisation narrative, which postulates that as societies progress and religious authority diminishes, belief in the supernatural and the social influence of religion will pass away entirely. Yet, the evidence suggests that this is simply not the case. In fact, exorcism is more popular today than at any point in history, with the exception of 15th and 16th century Europe. And it is probably safe to say that witch hysteria and the subsequent murder of thousands of innocents in the name of banishing demons did impact the believability of the existence of demons and throw suspicion on anyone who sees demonic reasons for common occurrences. Yet, where once the notion of demonic possession was ridiculed by even the Catholic Church, that very establishment has embraced exorcisms more in the past few decades than it has at any time since those centuries of witch hunts. Father Vincent Lampert, who is the designated exorcist of the Roman Catholic Archdiocese of Indianapolis, says that in 2005, when he was appointed, there were perhaps 12 exorcists across the US. Today, there are more than 50. Of course, it is fairly easy to dismiss the perspective of priests as clear religious bias and no proof at all of demons. But what if that testimony came from a psychiatrist? Dr. Richard Gallagher is a board-certified psychiatrist in New York State. He graduated from Princeton and trained in psychiatry at Yale. He is a professor of psychiatry at New York Medical and a psychoanalyst on the faculty of Columbia University. His psychiatric credentials are clear, yet for the past two decades, Dr. Gallagher has been a consultant to exorcists. His role is to clinically assess people identified as possibly being under demonic attack. In his book, Demonic Foes, published by HarperCollins in 2020, Dr. Gallagher outlines several cases where his assumptions and beliefs were challenged by the apparently unexplainable presentation of otherwise mentally healthy subjects. He says he is an avowed man of science, and the scientific protocols to assess such a case are very rigorous. He does stress that in his psychiatric practice of over 25,000 formal patients, he has never come across a patient whom he believes to be possessed or under demonic attack in any way. Yet, in his work consulting with the International Association of Exorcists, he has seen people for whom he is unable to provide a clinical diagnosis of a physical or mental illness, yet their disturbing symptoms remain. Dr. Gallagher says he is not alone. There are several other psychiatrists and mental health professionals who also consult on these types of cases, but few are willing to speak about it publicly, fearing damage to their professional reputations. And he states clearly that he isn't trying to change anybody's mind, and admits that for some, his testimony will be dismissed and even ridiculed. However, he says he has seen a little over 100 demonic possessions in his 25 years involved in these consultations. He draws a distinction between what he calls demonic oppression, which he says are less dramatic attacks by spiritual beings, and possession, where an evil spirit has control of a person and completely takes them over. Dr. Gallagher does insist that he never diagnoses anyone as possessed or even oppressed. His role is to diagnose a mental health issue, if and where it exists, and where he can't find a scientific explanation for the individual's problems, he then refers them back to their priest, rabbi, imam, or whatever spiritual advisor sent them to him. Essentially, once the physical and mental ailment avenues have been exhausted, the spiritual advisor must make the final determination of possession. The criteria for an assessment of possession is quite rigid, and the person must be displaying more than one of a raft of signs, such as trance-like states, demonic voices, the tendency to hostility towards religious articles and artifacts, a sudden fluency in foreign languages, knowledge of the unknown or unknowable, superhuman strength, and the most rare phenomenon, levitation. Dr. Gallagher outlines one extraordinary case of a woman he calls Julia. She was in her 40s and was a high priestess of a satanic cult. The night before he met Julia for the first time, he and his wife were in bed asleep when they were suddenly awakened at around 3 a.m. by their normally docile cats going absolutely berserk, fighting each other. Gallagher and his wife separated the cats and returned to bed, completely mystified as to what might make the cats behave that way. The following morning, Father Jack arrived on his doorstep with Julia, who quipped, "Well, Doc, how did you like those cats last night?" Dr. Gallagher claims she had the ability to know things she couldn't have known, like that his mother had died from ovarian cancer, and that she was also capable of remote viewing, the ability to see people who were not physically present and know what they were doing. And this was tested in his sessions with her. Dr. Gallagher says he also consulted with two psychiatrists who had previously assessed Julia, and their only diagnosis was a personality disorder formed by years of a somewhat unsavoury demeanour. On one occasion, he states he was riding in a car with Father Jack and Julia was in the back seat. Suddenly, a deep, raspy voice boomed out of Julia saying, "Leave her alone, you effing monkey priest." And Julia herself had taken on a vacant look. She later snapped out of her trance and had no recollection at all of what had happened or even how far they'd travelled. He says he's seen many cases of multiple personality disorder, but this was nothing like that. The Julia case would eventually have no real conclusion, although Julia did want to rid herself of the spirit which possessed her. She didn't want to give up her position in the church or renounce Satan because, he says, she enjoyed the powers it bestowed upon her. Nevertheless, they did perform a few exorcisms with Julia, during which she unleashed horrific verbal attacks on the nuns present, and the demon which possessed her apparently writhed in pain upon contact with holy water, but showed no reaction to tap water. The temperature in the room fluctuated from icy cold to stifling hot, and Julia was observed to levitate off her chair for a period of half an hour. Dr. Gallagher says Julia was never successfully delivered from evil, and she fell out of contact with the priest and the doctor. They did hear from her 2 years later when she contacted them to say that she was dying of cancer and was considering restarting her sessions, but she never called again. Dr. Gallagher also says that he's met many people who believe they're possessed when they're not. He says sometimes it's just a delusion, or sometimes the person is a psychotic schizophrenic, and at other times, they're just very suggestible, And in all of those cases, exorcisms absolutely aren't performed. The person is referred to mental health supports appropriate to their individual needs. And we know that there are a raft of truly disturbing cases where people have performed exorcisms with disastrous consequences. Often the methods used in those cases are a violent beating of the supposed demon out of the afflicted, and it is certain these cases would have never gained approval for an official exorcism, which is, they say, more of a battle on a spiritual level between the priest and the spirit, and it seldom requires physical contact between the two, other than the possible anointing with holy water. It's probably that those cases were a case of mental illness, and not just in the afflicted person. But if we do accept that demons and evil spirits exist, then we have to ask ourselves why they would bother possessing or oppressing everyday people. What could they possibly hope to gain? Some would say mischief, that their motivation is causing havoc. But the Mormon Church has an interesting take on this very question. The Mormon Church, or the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, has no prescribed rituals for exorcism. Despite this, there are numerous records of LDS priests casting out spirits. In Latter-day Saint theology, when Lucifer was hurled from heaven, he and his demons were denied access to bodies to shelter their spirits, but instead made to go abroad on the earth, naked and bare and exposed to the elements. This, they say, makes the demons crave the protection of the human body. We all have opinions, and whatever you believe, it is an interesting topic with roots which stretch way back in human history. And Dr. Richard Gallagher wants you to know that from his experience, there is more to demonic possession than mental illness can explain. I'd love to hear your thoughts on any of this. You know me, I'm sitting right in my normal position on the fence here. I'm open to arguments from either side. Thank you so much for watching and for your support of the channel. Remember to subscribe and hit that bell icon, setting notifications to all so you can stay up to date with all of the latest paranormal content on this channel. I'll see you next time.